on the Trans-Canada Highway in Calgary, more specifically, we're at 310 16th Avenue Northwest. This is where the controversial Roy Farran, for many years, edited the Rocky View News and the North Hill News. Today, this building houses a furniture rental store and a tattoo parlor. Publishing has changed. With the exception of my parents, Roy Farran was probably the most important single influence in my life. When I was 16, I went to work for him as his cub reporter on the North Hill and Rocky View News. Mr. Farran taught me how to write, clear, direct, precise. He taught me the journalist's social responsibility and the importance of skepticism. These qualities helped me through my career as a university professor and dean. I've always been very proud of my association with Mr. Farran, so you can imagine how shaken I was when last year the historian David Cesarani published a book, Major Farran's Hat. It found Mr. Farran guilty of the abduction, torture, and murder of a 16-year-old Jewish boy, Alexander Rubovitz. At the time, Farran, who was a British war hero, was in charge of an anti-insurgency unit during the last days of the British Mandate in Palestine. Now, when I worked for Mr. Farran, I'd heard that he'd had these charges against him and that he had a reputation for anti-Semitic remarks in public. But I didn't know what to make of that. I couldn't believe them. To me, he had seemed a very devout man, an honorable man. He'd always treated me generously in every way but paychecks. And I figure maybe he even hired me as a gesture of peace towards the Calgary Jewish community. Now I have to ask myself some serious questions. What do I make of my old hero now? He was the courageous editor who exposed one corrupt mayor, who fought against fluoridation, who fought for the ward system, all for the highest principle. But he's also the man who apparently abducted, tortured, and murdered a young freedom fighter. And what about my part in his rehabilitation? Was I too eager to believe his innocence rather than face the facts back then? How did my minor part in his career help him bury his past and launch that spectacular political career? How proud can I now be of that short, brilliant career I had in journalism? These are some of the issues I deal with in my new book, Roy and Me, This Is Not a Memoir. It's published by Athabasca University Press, free online and in a bargain paperback. Part of the book is my memoir of my relationship with Roy Farran. Another part is my invention of his reminiscences. At the end, I imagine a dialogue between him and me about our respective guilts and innocence. So it's an exercise in creative nonfiction. Part of it is memoir, part of it is fantasy. Now, we all know that memoirs are tinged with subjectivity at the most objective of times. This just pushes it a little further. In this book, I go back over 50 years to the beginning of my adult thinking and questions about my responsibility as much as Mr. Farran's. I wonder how guilty he was and how guilty I was in not confronting the facts that I'd heard. And I wonder how wrong I was and how wrong Mr. Farran was and what it matters. I still don't know what to make of Roy Farran, my old hero. And that's after writing the book and even after reading it. I hope readers will have a look at the book and perhaps come to terms with their own issues on responsibility and redemption. So here are this furniture rental and tattoo parlor. But don't be deceived by appearances. This building has a past. This is where Roy Farran tried to bury his history and where my adult career began. There are ghosts here, and they won't stay quiet.